Our announcements for Sunday, April the 23rd. Let me begin by wishing all of our April birthdays a happy birthday. Do we have anyone here that's celebrating a birthday today, or celebrated a birthday last week, or will celebrate a birthday this week? If so, show your hand and we'll recognize you right now. Amen. Hey, when is it? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. To all of our April birthdays, we say happy birthday. This is a reminder that prayer and praise Tuesdays and Fridays at 7 a.m. And if you have not joined this worship experience, you are cheating yourself. Those of you that work may not be able to listen and join, but if you are at home and have not tried the prayer line on Tuesdays and Friday mornings, you are missing a blessing. It's nothing formal. It's just some folks coming together to pray and thank the Lord. Amen. Bible study, Wednesdays at 11 a.m. The lesson is from Precepts for Living. And then on next Sunday, the missionaries will celebrate their annual day. Yeah. Reverend Claudine Murphy, a dynamic preacher, will be here to bless our souls. Wednesday evening Bible studies will resume on May the 3rd. I'll say that again. Wednesday evening Bible study resumes May the 3rd. And then the National Day of Prayer. Our prayer walk, May 4th. If you will notice the flyer, it will give the detailed information as to what time we will assemble on the parking lot. Prayer walk, where you can walk and pray and talk to Jesus. Amen. So concludes our announcements. Many of you may be wondering why I am standing here in place of your pastor, and many of you are already aware that our pastor this morning is enjoying Gay Perry. I have already received a text message from her. They all arrived safely. She is enjoying herself, and I asked her to please have a good time. This is a much deserved vacation, which I know all of you are fully aware of. So as the service goes on, please continue to lift up our pastor. We thank her for all that she does, and she did send prayers that we would have a joyful time this morning. Amen. We be without the Lord. Father God, you are welcome in this place. Like the dew in the morning, gently rest upon our hearts. Father God, we come to give you glory, we come to give you honor, and we come to give you praise. Father God, if we had 10,000 tongues, we couldn't praise you enough this morning. But Father God, we have come and we thank you for your presence. And we ask God that if you can only dwell with us for a little bit, that'll be all right with us. We welcome you. We invite you, Lord, come into this place and have your way. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Makes no difference what you're going through. You're gonna make it. God's gonna see you through. Hold your head up. Put a smile on your face. This is only a test. It won't last always. Get it ready.
For your blessing,
yeah.
For your blessing.
Getting ready.
Get ready.
blessing, yeah, yeah.
For your blessing.
Get ready.
Get ready.
For your miracle.
For your miracle.
Ready.
Get ready.
For your blessing, yeah.
For your blessing.
Get ready.
Get ready.
For your miracle.
For your miracle.
God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Say it like you know it. God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Anybody believe it today? Yeah. God's got a blessing.
God's got a blessing.
Here we go. Let's rock. Come on, Billy. Play it out. God's got a blessing.
With my name on it.
With my name on it.
With my name on it.
open up with, God's got a blessing. Huh? With your name on it. You got a miracle with your name on it. Now I want you to think back, if you can go back that far, to the miracle of your birth. Birth is a miracle. We don't understand birth because it's something that God did. He didn't want us to understand it. He just did it because he loved us. But guess what? He did it again. Oh, because you've been born again. And I've been born again. So we got a double miracle. All right. Yes, indeed. I feel good this morning. I feel good to stand here this morning and tell you that I am double blessed because I've been born again. Oh, ain't it all right? And ain't he all right that we have been born again? My Lord, as I stand here to do the affirmation of faith, it's found in your bulletin. If you don't know it, please stand and join with me as we confirm our belief. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may
sent your offerings in. Or perhaps when you leave, you will leave your offering then. It's a blessing to be able to give to God who gives everything to us. Those of you that are viewing with us virtually, you already know the various means of Cash App or whatever the church uses to send their offering. We want to thank you for your offering uplifts the church. God does not have a need for our money. Amen, somebody. But we give for the uplifting of God's kingdom. So we thank you, those that have given, those that will give. And as we leave the church, there will be an officer waiting on you to receive your offering. Let us thank God at this time. Father, we can't beat you here. No matter how we try. Father God, we want to thank you for what you have given us, what you have entrusted us with. And Father God, we count it not robbery to give back to you. We just can't beat you giving, God. And not only do you bless us financially, but sometimes when we're sick and we feel us, it's because of how we've given. I think sometimes when we're lonely and in despair, you come and visit us because of what you've given. Oh, Father God, we thank you for every good and perfect gift that comes from you. And Father God, we ask that you would bless the offering from your children. Father God, I want to thank you that they were able to give. And then, Father God, perhaps there's one that just did not have it. We're asking that you would bless them, Lord. As We thank you in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, how you walk with me. And oh, how you talk with me. And oh, how you tell me that I am your own. Oh, you all know we don't have nothing to worry about. Amen. Because he holds our hand. Remember when we were kids? When we first learned to walk and ride our bikes, and how mamas and daddies would hold our hand and we felt so secure. We could get ready to go into a dark room, and just because mom and daddy held our hand, we was all right until they turned the light on, because we held their hand. Well, our Father Church holds our hand. Amen. Amen. Giving reverence to God and honor to Pastor Renee T. Johnson as she vacations. I thank him for this opportunity to come before you to spread a little word about Jesus. If you would turn your attention to John, the 14th chapter, verses 25 and 26. Also John 16, 5 through 7, 12 and 13, and I will be reading from the New King James Version. John 14, 25 and 26, and as you've located on your tablets or phones and in your Bibles, I want to thank my brother for being here to support me this morning. I was hoping, I said, Lord, he wasn't able to be here last week, but I need you to have Brother Tyson up in the pulpit with me so I won't feel alone. And I'm asking your prayers. And before I start, let me thank each and every one of you respectively, because many of you knew that the pastor was out of town, and you could have decided to make this the Sunday that you don't come to church. And I want to thank you right now, first, for loving your church so much that whether the pastor's here or not, you are here. And then I want to thank you personally, because no one wants to look out into an audience and see an empty pew. Amen. John 14, 25 and 26. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. John 16, 5 and 7. But now I go away to him who sent me, and none of you ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. 12 and 13. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. I want to speak with you for a moment on the subject, name it and claim it. Name it and claim it. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Lord, I'm not concerned about preaching a good sermon, but yet I want to preach a sermon that does some good. In Jesus' name, amen. Name it and claim it. Now, church, I'm about to quote a couple of phrases that I'm sure many of you have heard. If you be honest with yourselves, you probably said it. And I'll confess to start with that I have said all of these quotes that I'm getting ready to share with you. Something told me to do that. I should have followed my first mind. You all don't have to raise your hand, but I could tell from your expression where I'm going here. Something kept prodding me all day long. I have this urge. I have this nudging. Something keeps telling me to do this and do that. Well, church, it's time to name it and claim it. The text clearly identifies who and what is working inside of us. Jesus loves us so much that not only did he die for us, but he left the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us in all truth. Church, it's time we name it and claim it. It's not something. It's not an urge. It's not a prodding. It's the Holy Spirit. We give a name and a title to anything and anybody, but when it comes to the Holy Spirit, we don't want to give it a name. In this text that was read for you, Jesus prepares for his return to the Father. He tells the disciples that though he is leaving, he loves us so much that he will leave behind a comforter, the Holy Spirit, that will teach us, lead us, guide us in all truth, and teach us of things to come. Church, we've got to start naming it and claiming it. We got to name it because God named everything that he created. Let me show you. When Moses asked God, what should I tell the people? When they asked me who sent you, God named himself. He said, tell them I am has sent you. Adam was responsible for naming everything that God created. God told Mary and Joseph to name the baby Jesus. He didn't say something. He told Zacharias to name his son John, who later became John the Baptist. And church, you know for a fact, before a mother is discharged from the hospital, her child has to have a name. I started pondering reasons why we don't acknowledge the Holy Spirit when it is working inside of us. And again, church, remember now, I've already confessed that I have done the same thing. Just the other day, I got ready to say something, and I'm like, oh, no, and, you know, something, it's got a name. But I begin to ponder why we don't acknowledge the Holy Spirit. And one thing I came to is maybe we are worried about what others may think. We are concerned that if we acknowledge the Holy Spirit, folks will think we're crazy. They'll get to saying, oh, those just one of those religious fanatics. So we're hesitant to give the Holy Spirit recognition. But newsflash, church, they think we're crazy anyway. Come on now, I know some of you have heard this expression. I wouldn't be giving all my money to that preacher. Come on, somebody, I know you've heard it. When people find out that you tithe and you give your money to the church, and not only don't they say you give it to the church, but you're giving it to that preacher. Before the pandemic, we were spending 2 and 3 evenings a week at the church. Two or three days a week at the church. You all remember, if you sang in the choir, if you usher, if you on any kind of board, everybody was having meetings at the church. So you were subject to be spending 2 and 3 days at the church. And tell me that people don't think you're crazy, because the first thing they'll say is, I wouldn't be spending all of my time down at that church. But it was all right when we were spending all that time with them in the boys and at parties and at social events. But now that we have turned our lives over to the Lord, all of a sudden we're crazy. Well, church, it was all right when we were out in the world. But now that we're trying to be disciplined in how we live our lives, we are crazy. But the word of God says that we are a peculiar people, set apart. Church, we are different. And I don't know about you, but I don't care what somebody think. I'll be crazy for Christ any day. And I don't care what anybody thinks about it. And then the question came, why are we concerned about what other people think? Who are we really concerned about? Surely it's not a Christian. Surely we're not concerned about a follower of Jesus Christ who already knows the Spirit lives and dwells within us. So then why would we be concerned with a non-believer? If we don't believe and acknowledge the Holy Spirit working in us, how then can we convince others? But church, be careful of being ashamed of letting someone know that the Spirit dwells in you, because God said in His word, if you are ashamed of me down here, I'm going to be ashamed of you up there. Hallelujah, somebody. We must be like the Apostle Paul, who declared, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Church, it's time to move from something. It's time to move from an urge. It's time to move from first mind. Let's name it and claim it. 1 John 2:27 states that the Holy Spirit teaches us concerning all things, and it is true, it is not a lie. How many of you have ever heard somebody say, I wish I had not listened to my first mind? Have any of you ever heard anybody say that? How many of you have ever said, I should not have paid attention to that urging? And what I'm speaking of, church, is if you're used to going a certain route in your travels, and the Spirit tells you to go a different way, you don't know what's up ahead. But here comes the Holy Spirit that will guide us, what? In all truth. And if you don't go the way that the Spirit is leading you, when you get to your regular route, it's going to be a detour. Somebody going to be working on the road. It's going to be something, and the Spirit is going to remind you, I told you to go left. But you was determined to go right. Oh, I knew I should have followed my first man. How many of you have heard somebody say, oh, I shouldn't have followed my first man? Because I don't know about you, church, but every time the Spirit leads me to do something, it might not make sense then. But when it happens, the first thing you say to yourself, that's why the Spirit put that on my heart. Come on, somebody. How many times have we known people that we woke up with them on our mind? All day long, we just kept thinking about them. Didn't stop to pray. Didn't try to reach out to them. And then we find out that either they're sick or they done passed on. And church, let's be honest. The first thing we say, I should have followed my first man. I knew for some reason the Lord had put that person on my heart. Church, the scripture says the Spirit will lead us for things to come. God already knows the big picture. All we know, church, is what we see before us. I looked up the word something. And it means a thing that is unspecified or unknown. Now, church, I know we can do better than that. I know we know about the Spirit. We cannot claim to be children of the Most High God. Invite the Holy Spirit to come into our sanctuary and into our temples and not recognize the Holy Spirit for who it is. Jesus never said, I'm leaving behind something. Come on, church. But he told them, he said, I'm leaving you a comforter, an advocate. God was intentional on all his creation having a name. We begin our worship Sunday on Sunday mornings. I know the pastor does it and I've done it too. We invite the Holy Spirit to come and dwell amongst us. Yet, we don't want to acknowledge the Holy Spirit. Instead, we call it something. We call it a first man. We call it an urge. Church, it's time to name it and claim it. You can call it advocate, comforter, intercessor, Holy Spirit. God sent the Holy Spirit to teach us all things and to remind us of everything that he has said to us. The Holy Spirit empowers us to do all things we are called to do. Church, it is because of the Holy Spirit that we live, move, and have our being. The Holy Spirit leads us and guides us in all truths. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us and gives us direct access to the Father. Church, when we don't know what to pray, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. Yet we don't want to give it a name. We want to call it something. First man. Urge. Prodding. We got to declare through the Holy Spirit. It will declare to us the things to come. God knows tomorrow. We don't. We have enough to do just trying to get through today. But church, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Upon the mountain, my Lord spoke. Out of his mouth came fire and smoke. All around me, the world so fine, I asked the Lord if all was mine. Jordan River is chilly and cold. It chills the body, but not the soul. There ain't but one train upon this track, and it runs from heaven, and it runs right back. Oh, I have trials, and I have woes, and I have heartaches here below. But while God leads me, I'll never fear, for I'm sheltered by all his care. Church, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I'm going to say, thank you, Jesus. And like I told you a couple of weeks ago, I was packing to go out of town. And while I was watching a basketball game, of all times, the Spirit told me to get a particular item. And I'm thinking to myself, Lord, I'm sitting here trying to enjoy this game. I'm chilling out. But you know, when the Spirit speaks to us, it picks its time. Come on, somebody. And for some reason, this time I obeyed the Spirit and I got up and got the item. But church, at the time when I got it, I didn't even understand what I would need it for. But when I got to my destination, hallelujah, that very item that the Spirit told me to get, I needed it. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I pray. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I'm going to obey. Church, it's time to name it, and it's time to claim it. We need to stop telling folk about something told us. Wasn't no something. Why not let somebody know that the Holy Spirit lives within you? Amen. The doors of the church are open. Hallelujah. The doors of the church are open. You know, the pastor has a threefold invitation. The first is for our salvation. Just because you come to church every Sunday, just because you read the word, does not mean that you are saved. If you have not turned your life over to Christ, this is your opportunity. If you are viewing with us virtually, the call goes out to you also. Don't worry about what you've done. Don't even be concerned with what you're doing. Just come and watch what God will do. He'll change you. He'll rearrange you. He'll turn you upside down and then right back, right side up. Dedication. Perhaps you've been living outside of the will of Christ and you know it. Perhaps you're not praying as much as you know you are. This is your opportunity to rededicate your life, to reconnect with Christ. And then finally, description of God, you may remain standing. If any of three, salvation, the call for rededication, and the call for prayer, just because we sit down, that don't mean that we're not in the need of prayer. Let that be understood. Everybody's not able to stand for a long time. So when you look around the sanctuary and see people sitting, that does not mean that they do not need prayer. Amen. So is anyone heeding the call for salvation? Is anyone heeding the call for rededication? If everyone's standing for prayer, let us pray. Father God, starting today, we're going to name it. Father God, you gave us the Holy Spirit to comfort us and to guide us and to lead us into all truths and to even reveal to us things to come. So, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we're coming to the only help that we know. Father, God, Jesus, I ask that you would grant their prayer requests. Oh, Father God, if they've been praying for a long time, tell them to hold on, not to give up. Sometimes you tell us to wait. Sometimes you say not now. Then sometimes you say no. So, Father God, we're asking that you would help them to accept what your will is in their lives. But most of all, God, please, please, Father, you told them to cast all of their cares upon you. That's what they're doing, God. They're looking to the hills from which cometh their help, for they know that their help cometh from the Lord. Father God, as we pray, we lift up Sister Charlene Gunn and her husband, Brother Calvin. Father God, we need you to go to that hospital right now in the name of Jesus. In fact, Lord, I know you're already there. So what I'm going to do, Lord, I'm going to switch this prayer. I'm going to thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do through the doctors and through their faith in you. This is where faith is being put to the test, God.
No searching of your power.
We lift up Sister Melba Sims, recovering from surgery on her hand. Father God, you are a healer. And I know, Father God, that you're going to make her whole. But Father God, we pray that she'll be patient. Because we have a tendency to do more than what we need to be doing. So Father God, give her wisdom as you heal her body. And then before I close this prayer, Lord, we thank you that our pastor made it safely. And Father God, we're asking that you would bless Reverend Renee T. Johnson. Let this be a time of enjoyment for her, Lord. And we know that you're going to speak to her, but Father God, we want you to calm any fear that she may have, any concern that she may have about her mother. Let her know right now in the name of Jesus that everything is okay. And Father God, we'll be mindful to give you all the honor, all of the glory, and all of the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Name it and claim it. Thank you for being here today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you peace. 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 As you go, tell the world. Tell the world about Jesus. Tell them about his love. As you go, church, tell the world. In the name of the Father, amen. And God bless you.
Let's welcome at this time Twinkie Clark and the fabulous Clark sisters.
We're so happy to be in your city. We want to let you know that we didn't come all the way from Detroit to look at y'all. We didn't come here to let you know that we could sing. But we come here to let you know that Jesus is the baddest man in town. All you got to do is give your life to him. I wonder if I got a witness out there. How many of y'all come to have church? Meditate.